Welcome back to The Heat as we continue our discussion on growing support in Europe for Palestinian statehood. Joining me now from San Francisco is Omar Dajani. He is a Palestinian American professor and a former member of the PLO negotiation team. Omar, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
What is the significance of these developments in Europe and this growing support for Palestinian statehood?
Well, I think that as a gesture of support for Palestinians' right to self-determination, it's symbolically very important. But I think for many Palestinians, there's a feeling that it's a little too little, a little too late. What they're after is something more tangible. They are looking to the Security Council to endorse a Palestinian resolution or a resolution submitted by the Palestinians that would call upon Israel unequivocally to end its occupation of the Palestinian territory. They're looking for the international community to define clear parameters for negotiations between the parties. And they're looking for criminal accountability for Israeli war crimes. So while these statements of recognition of the of Palestinian national aspirations are welcome, I think the hope is that they'll lead to something much more.
Right. You say they are symbolic, and that is exactly what Israel is saying as well. I mean, should it be thought of in any other terms?
Well, I think that they can be understood as an opening of doors. I mean, if you look at the resolution passed by the United Nations General Assembly now a couple of years ago, granting Palestine recognition as a non-member observer state, that's opened the doors to a variety of benefits within international arenas, so things as diverse as ensuring that the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem is a UNESCO World Heritage Site, giving it additional protection and assistance in its maintenance, all the way over to allowing Palestinians to press for equal treatment in the International Telecommunications Union so that their mobile carriers get better treatment by Israel. But while all of those measures have been helpful, they have advanced the ball to some extent. I think that at this juncture, Palestinians are not so much looking for the international community to recognize that Palestinians have a right to self-determination, but to take concrete action to press Israel to realize the that goal. And I think that that's forthcoming as of yet.
Well, let's look at some of the other reaction from the Israelis. The Israeli embassy in London released a statement in which it said that the action by the British House of Commons, as well as in Sweden, action by the Swedish Parliament, and proposed action in other European countries actually sends a very troubling message to the Palestinian leadership. It says it's allowing Palestinians to evade what it calls hard choices that the Palestinian leadership will have to make regarding peace, and that it undermines the chances for peace. What's your response to that?
Well, I think that's nonsense. I mean, if you go back to 1949, when Israel was itself seeking membership in the United Nations and recognition as a state, its ambassador, Abba Iban, made the point that equality of status was a necessary condition for moving forward in relations with the Arab states and the rest of the international community. What was right for Israel at that juncture is obviously right for Palestinians at this point. What Palestinians are looking for is not a unilateral step, but instead a fundamentally multilateral step, recognition from the international community that Palestinians have a right to an equal place in the Assembly of Nations, and a right also to the full array of protections that human rights instruments provide Palestinians. And I think the notion that negotiations would be undermined rather than facilitated by this is utterly wrong.
Right, it might be symbolic, but we know that in international politics and diplomacy, symbolism means a lot. As we heard our reporter say at the outset of the program, there's a head of steam growing across Europe for a pan-European resolution for Palestinian statehood, Palestinian recognition. What would that mean for Palestinians in real terms and concrete terms? What is the change?
Well, you know, I think that what's very exciting in Europe right now is that you see a dramatic shift over the last year and a half in European states' willingness to actually attach real incentives to their demands, not only for Palestinian statehood, but also for an end to occupation. Thus, European states have issued warnings, like Britain and Spain have, to their businesses saying, be careful about investing in the occupied territories. They could cost you in terms of reputation. They could cost you in terms of legal action. They have made it much more difficult for Israeli settlement products to penetrate the European markets. And they have also begun the process of indicating that Israelis themselves may have difficulty traveling to Europe if they don't begin to take action toward peace. I think the movement toward recognition of Palestinian statehood is a very positive development, and I think as a complement to these other steps, which are meant to create incentives for Israel to end its occupation, we could see something transformative in the works.
Right, and the one other reality that Palestinians would have to face, of course, is looking at the viability of a two-state solution, given that the Israelis have, you know, continued extensive settlement building in the West Bank, they continue the blockade of Gaza. What are the chances of a two-state solution at this stage?
Well, I think the chances are getting slimmer and slimmer as we go. I think that the greatest single challenge remains Israel's continuing settlement construction. And the difficulty is that many feel that the occupation has metastasized, that it has moved beyond a point where it can be reversed through a simple act of drawing a border between two states. I think for that reason, it's all the more important that steps be taken to reverse Israeli settlement activity and also to reimagine the two-state solution in ways that might make it more durable. To think, for example, about drawing a border between Israel and Palestine, a future state of Palestine that is regulated but permeable, in which Palestinians and Israelis can move across it with freedom. I think that that sort of step could make the two-state solution a viable prospect again. But at present, things are looking more and more worrying for its prospects.
And one very quick question, Omar. We just got a few seconds left. Does anything change for the Palestinians? Because Israel's main benefactor, its supporter, its banker, in fact, the United States, is not changing its policy.
Well, I think that while the United States is important, Europe has moved into a very central position. And it's important to remember that Europe is Israel's largest trading partner, and that Europe is in a position, consequently, to make the array of incentives that it offers Israel have real effect. And so I hope that Europe will lead the United States, and it has in the past, for example, with respect to recognizing the importance of Palestinian statehood. But even on its own merits, Europe can have a tremendous influence.
Always great having you on, Omar. Omar Dajani, they're talking to us from San Francisco.
Thank you, Anand.